Right friends, welcome back to News Analysis and Features. So this is 30th week, and this week we are going to discuss two important aspects. One is Iran nuclear deal, how the world views it. The second one is New Horizons spacecraft, surprising revelations from Pluto by New Horizons spacecraft. First and foremost is Iran nuclear deal, and part of this we discussed when we were discussing the week, probably the last week of March. Not only that, in the 29th week also, we discussed something about Iran nuclear deal. Now we are going to discuss in totality exactly what Iran nuclear deal is, right? So the relations between Iran and the United States of America were strained. Iran Islamic Revolution took place in the year 1979. At that time, the Pahlavi dynasty, supported by United States of America, was overthrown. Pahlavi dynasty, supported by United States of America, was overthrown, and subsequently, the relations between Iran and the United States of America strained for the past 30-35 years. And in the year 2003, America felt that the Iran nuclear program is not peaceful. It is going to manufacture nuclear weapons. In the year 2003, United States of America felt that the nuclear program of Iran is not going to be peaceful, and it's going to develop nuclear weapons. That means it has attained the capability to develop nuclear weapons. Subsequently, from the year 2003, quite on and off for the past 12 years, these discussions were held with Iran to stop the production of nuclear weapons. For the past 12 years, quite off and on, negotiations were held, and the countries participated in these discussions are 6 countries. The 6 countries are popularly known as P5+1. P5+1 means, P5 means permanent members of Security Council. All of you are well aware, these 5 members, that is United States of America, United Kingdom, China, Russia and France, these 5 countries are permanent members of United Nations Security Council. And at the same time, along with these 5 countries, Germany also participated. These 6 countries, sometimes known as E3+3. 3 countries of European Union, Germany, France, UK, and 3 other countries, United States of America, Russia and China. So when it is E3+3 or P5+1 or 6 nations, it is one and the same. These countries participated in the discussions with Iran for the past several years, and ultimately an agreement was reached. Right? What are the main features of agreement? Let us discuss. First thing is, Iran agreed to get rid of 98% of its stockpile of enriched uranium. Iran agreed to get rid of 98% of its stockpile of enriched uranium. You may ask, what is enriched uranium? Right? Please look into this picture. Natural uranium constitutes just 0.7% of U-235 and more than 99% of U-238. Just 0.7% of U-235 and 99% of U-238. We are bothered about U-235 only because U-235 is a fissile material which generates a chain reaction. Chain reaction is possible only with U-235. U-235 is a fissile material. U-238 is not. But in natural uranium, U-235 is just 0.7%. And U-238 is 99%, more than 99%. And what is the difference between U-235 and U-238? These two are the isotopes of uranium. You may ask, what is isotope? When the neutrons differ, they are called isotopes. You see, when you take U-235, it constitutes 92 protons and 143 neutrons. 92 protons and 143 neutrons. If you take U-238, 92 protons and 146 neutrons. So there is a difference of 3 neutrons between U-235 and U-238. We are concerned about U-235, which is a fissile material, or you can say which can instigate chain reaction, which is required in the reactors or for making atomic bombs and all. So increasing U-235 component is nothing but enrichment of uranium, right? Increasing the U-235 component is enriched uranium, right? So for reactor grade uranium, please don't forget, the natural uranium has got just 0.7% of U-235, and for reactor grade it requires around 3 to 5%. If the uranium is enriched to 3 to 5%, that is enough for nuclear reactor grade. That means for producing energy, for producing nuclear power, 3 to 5% of enrichment is enough. But to produce nuclear weapons, 90% enrichment is required. For producing nuclear weapons, 90% enrichment is required. And the world's contention is Iran has got the capability and it produced weapons grade enriched uranium. The world's contention is Iran, instead of producing reactor grade uranium, that is just 3 to 5% of U-235, Iran produced weapons grade uranium, that is 90% U-235, right? Now, in the discussions, it was decided that Iran will agree to get rid of 98% of its stockpile of enriched uranium. Second thing is centrifuges. These are gas centrifuges, which are needed to enrich uranium, will be reduced from 19,000 to 6,000. You may ask, how to increase the percentage of U-235 in uranium? We have just now learned 0.7% of U-235 will be there in natural uranium. We have to increase U-235 component so as to make it reactor grade or weapons grade. But how to increase the percentage of U-235? For increasing the percentage of U-235, we use centrifuges. Please look into this picture. These are centrifuges which are used for enriching uranium. Iran has got 19,000 centrifuges and they agreed to reduce from 19,000 to 6,000. Right? Third point is enrichment will be stopped at underground Fardo facility. Enrichment will be stopped at underground Fardo facility. Fourth point is the strict inspections by IAEA. What is IAEA? Please look into this picture. IAEA is International Atomic Energy Agency based in Vienna in Austria, established in the year 1957, and this International Atomic Energy Agency will send its inspectors to inspect the facilities and also to make sure that Iran is not making enrichment of uranium up to weapons grade, right? Enriching uranium up to 90% is dangerous, and IAEA inspectors will ensure that Iran will not make the enrichment up to weapons grade, right? And other parts of the agreement include United Nations arms embargo will remain in place for 5 years, and again embargo on missiles will be there for 8 years. So after 5 years, the restriction on transfer of arms, that means United Nations restriction on purchase of arms, will go away after 5 years, right? So these are the salient points of the agreement. So we have clearly discussed about what is P5+1, what is E3+3, what is meant by centrifuges, what is meant by enriched uranium, what is meant by IAEA, and now let us come back to the main point. After the nuclear deal, what does it mean to the world as a whole from Iran's perspective and all? First thing is, for world as a whole, what does it mean? First and the foremost thing is reduction in oil prices, because Iran is also one of the major producer of oil. So far trade restrictions are there. That's why now when the trade restrictions go away, Iran also can export oil. That's why reduction in oil prices may take place. Then may further cripple oil rich countries' economies, because oil prices are going down day by day. It already crippled several economies. Russia is also one economy which is affected due to downslide in oil prices. Venezuela's economy was affected. Where is Venezuela? Venezuela is South American country, and it may further cripple the oil rich countries' economies because further slide in oil prices. Third thing is, opening up of markets of Iran may benefit advanced economies. Advanced economies are not performing well, and Iran may be another opportunity for them to improve their businesses. Fourth is reduction of hostilities in the world. Right? Reduction of hostilities, because now USA, other Western countries and Iran may somewhat become closer, so hostilities may come down. Then how it will benefit Iran? Sanctions will go away in due course of time once these things are ensured, once the IAEA inspectors confirm with regard to the nuclear capabilities, with regard to the centrifuges. When all the systems as agreed to are in place, then what will happen? This trade embargo or sanctions will go away against Iran one by one, and subsequently it will benefit the Iran economy. Initially, it may benefit its shipping, it may benefit its oil companies, airline sector. Second thing is resumption of oil exports. Third is economy can be again on growth path. In recent years, because of sanctions imposed on Iran, its economy crippled by 20% in recent times. And as the sanctions will go away, it will strengthen Iran in Middle East. You may ask, what is Middle East? Between Egypt right up to Iran, that portion is called normally Middle East. In Middle East, now Saudi Arabia is one power center representing Gulf Cooperation Council. Now Iran may become another power center, and there are allegations that Iran is already supporting like Houthi rebels in Yemen as well as Hezbollah in Lebanon. So Iran may become another power center in Middle East, right? So this is from Iran's perspective. From Saudi Arabia and Israel point of view, I have already told you Saudi Arabia is one power center, and it may not like Iran to become another power center. And Israel is the staunch opponent of Iran, and Saudi Arabia and Israel says that it may lead to proliferation of arms. Third thing is space to build a nuclear arsenal. Israel says whatever the IAEA inspections are there, but there will be a space for Iran to build a nuclear arsenal, and it may create further unrest in Middle East. This is from Saudi Arabia and Israel's perspective, and to pacify their feelings, their friend America has sent its Ashton Carter, its defense secretary, to these two countries. And from Indian perspective, oil import bill may go down. Second thing is it may result in reduction in current account deficit. Third is Chabahar port. Chabahar port, please don't forget, it will give access to not only Afghanistan but also to Central Asia. Chabahar port may become a reality shortly. And once Chabahar port comes into picture, opening up the markets in the Central Asia may be to the India's advantage. But one negative aspect is India may be required to face competition as far as India's exports are concerned to Iran, because exports from European countries to Iran may be cheaper than exports from India. That is the point which we should not forget. And the final point is, some critics feel that Iran may checkmate organizations like ISIS in Middle East. Let us see, only time can say how it is going to transcend in future. Right friends, look into the next issue or the second issue of this news analysis and features. New Horizons spacecraft, 9.5 years and 5 billion kilometers. New Horizons spacecraft is to explore Pluto and Kuiper Belt. Right, we are going to discuss what is the Kuiper Belt and what is New Horizons. New Horizons is a part of a New Frontiers program launched by NASA. New Horizons program is a part of New Frontiers program. You may ask, what is the New Frontiers program? New Frontiers program at present has got 3 missions. The first mission is the New Horizons. New Horizons was launched in the year 2006. And this is basically to explore Pluto as well as Kuiper Belt. You may ask, what is the Kuiper Belt? Please look into this picture. Pluto is the dwarf planet. There are 8 planets in the solar system. Beyond 8 planets, the region is known as Kuiper Belt. Beyond 8 planets, the region is known as the Kuiper Belt, and Pluto is situated in the Kuiper Belt. What is Kuiper Belt? Kuiper Belt is the distance 30 astronomical units to 50 astronomical units. Is the distance from 30 astronomical units to 50 astronomical units. That portion is known as Kuiper Belt. That is beyond the planets of the solar system. Beyond the planets of the solar system, that is 30 astronomical unit or AU to 50 AU. That is Kuiper Belt. Pluto is situated in Kuiper Belt. And this New Horizons is to explore Kuiper Belt. You may ask, what is astronomical unit? You may ask, what is astronomical unit? Please look into this picture. Astronomical unit or 1 astronomical unit is the distance between Sun and the Earth. The distance between Sun and the Earth is 1 astronomical unit. And it is taken as average because you see the Earth's orbit is elliptical orbit. Sometimes it may be nearer, sometimes it may be farther. When the Earth is farther away from the Sun, it is called aphelion. And when the Earth is close to the Sun, it is perihelion. And the average of these 2 distances, 150 million kilometers, is considered as 1 AU. And Kuiper Belt is 30 AU to 50 AU, that is beyond the solar system, that is Kuiper Belt. And this New Horizons is to explore Pluto and Kuiper Belt. And second one is Juno. Juno was already launched in 2011 and it is going to go nearer to Jupiter in the year 2016. So basically Juno is to explore Jupiter. Right? Jupiter is one of the planets in the solar system. So Juno is to explore Jupiter. Third one is OSIRIS-REx to explore asteroids. You may ask, what is asteroids? Please look into this picture. There will be asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. There will be asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. And this OSIRIS-REx program is to explore the asteroid belt which is situated between Mars and Jupiter. So, 3 satellites or 3 spacecrafts are part of this New Frontiers program, that is the New Horizons for Kuiper Belt and Pluto. Juno is for Jupiter. Third one is OSIRIS-REx, that is for asteroids. Right? So, these 3 are part of New Frontiers program. Please look into this picture. There are 8 planets in the solar system. The first 4 are called rocky planets. First 4 are called rocky planets. And let us look at rocky planets. Rocky planets are Venus, Mercury, Earth and Mars. The first 4 planets adjacent to Sun are rocky planets. Next 2 are gas giants, Jupiter and Saturn. So, these are gas giants. Gas giants are Jupiter and Saturn, and predominantly lighter gases of hydrogen and helium will be there. So these two gas giants are made of hydrogen and helium. Please don't forget. And next two planets are ice giants. These ice giants are composed of oxygen, carbon, nitrogen and sulfur. This Uranus and Neptune. In the total 8 planets of the solar system, first 4 are rocky planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth and Mars. Next 2 are gas giants which composed of hydrogen and helium. Next 2 are ice giants composed of oxygen, carbon, nitrogen and sulfur. So this is about the planets of our solar system, and beyond this is Kuiper belt. Beyond this is Kuiper belt, and this dwarf planets are situated in the Kuiper belt, and this New Horizons spacecraft is basically to explore that, right? To explore Pluto, its moons, as well as Kuiper belt. So to explore these things, this New Horizons spacecraft is its prime mission, and this is to understand icy worlds at the edge of our solar system, because our solar system ends with the last planet, that is Neptune, and beyond that it is Kuiper belt. Just now I have told you, that means beyond 30 astronomical units, and now New Horizons spacecraft is basically to look into the features of this Kuiper belt, right? So this is to understand the icy worlds at the edge of our solar system, to have reconnaissance of Pluto and Kuiper belt objects. It will look into the surface properties of Pluto and geology, and what is the interior and what is the atmosphere. And if you look at it, it is by the Applied Physics Laboratory of Johns Hopkins University. John Hopkins University is situated in Baltimore, Maryland, United States of America, and ultimately data analysis is done by Southwest Research Institute in United States of America. It was launched on January 19, 2006, and flyby of Pluto occurred on 14th July 2015. You may ask, what is flyby? When a spacecraft approaches a planet for observation, that is known as a flyby. That means it is the close approach of a spacecraft to a planet for observation, then we say that is in the range of a flyby, right? So it approached flyby, that means it is in a position to take pictures of Pluto on July 14, 2015, and it was launched by Atlas V551 launch vehicle, right? And now, what are the findings of New Horizons? First and the foremost is how it is different from our solar system. 2-3 points it stated. First point is, it has a heart-shaped feature, which is a mountain range with the peaks up to around 3,500 meters. Please don't forget, our Everest is 8,848 meters. And it found mountains of peaks up to 3,500 meters, and they are young mountains. The interesting point is, the mountains are not older than 100 million years, whereas our solar system is 4.56 billion year old, but these mountains are not older than 100 million years. That is the first observation. Please look into this picture. These mountains, heart-shaped mountains, were found on Pluto. These are the pictures released by NASA. Second thing is, this region is geologically active even today. This region is geologically active even today. Second important point noticed by the New Horizons spacecraft is, vast craterless plains were also found. Vast craterless plains were also found. Please look into this picture. And the third important point is, flowing ice was also found. You see the flowing ice, please look into this picture. So that means the geological feature says that it is still active, right? So with this, let us conclude News Analysis and Features. Please do join for 31st week for News Analysis and Features. Have a nice day. Thank you.